Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for joining our live event here today. Today we are doing an alum success spotlight for some of our students that have come through our courses here at CircuitStream. Before we get started, I'm going to do a quick audio and visual check, just make sure that everybody can see me okay, everybody can hear me okay. So feel free to use the chat log off into the right-hand side there. Just let me know in the chat if everyone can see me and hear me okay. And I also like to invite everybody to share where they are joining us from. I personally am from Calgary, Alberta, Canada. That's where our company is founded from as well. So I don't see anything in the chat. Can somebody throw something into the chat here? There we go. Perfect. Awesome. Awesome. Hello, Xander. North Carolina. Awesome. Virginia. Amazing. Perfect, perfect. So I'm going to actually, before I share the presentation, I'm going to do a quick familiarization with the platform here. So you're using the chat log off in the bottom right-hand corner. If you notice down there, there's also a polls tab and a questions tab. At the very end of this session, we are going to do a little bit of Q&A with the audience with all three of our student alum. So feel free to put questions into that tab throughout the entire presentation. If we don't answer right away, it's because we're kind of holding until the end so that we can answer in front of everybody and kind of share the responses. I've also dropped a couple polls into the polls tab. So feel free to interact with those at any time throughout the presentation as well. I believe I'm asking what industry you're working in. And if you're looking at taking courses, kind of what sort of timeline that looks like, I believe those are the two that I put in there. So that's the platform here. Without further ado, I'm going to get started here and share a little bit about myself and a little bit about the company. So I'll put this over here. Just get my notes ready to go. Here we go. Perfect. So my name is Tyler. I work at CircuitStream. I've been with the company for just over 2 years. I previously worked in travel and tourism for 10 plus years, and I am a video game enthusiast myself. I always refer to myself as a senior Fortnite player. I am also going to take a moment now to announce who our speakers are going to be for today. They will be joining me on stage to share their stories in just a few minutes, but I'm just going to share a little bit of company and course information with everybody before we get into their sessions. First, we will have Miji joining us on stage in a little bit. Miji is an alum of our XR Development with Unity course. Miji is a kid at heart and recently discovered her love for skydiving. We were actually just talking about that before this event went live here today, and I was sharing how much I would probably not love skydiving, but she was sharing that I probably would. It's a little different than what you would imagine, or different than in video games, I guess, at the very least. So after Miji, we will have Angela join us on stage. Angela is an alum of our Interaction Design and Prototyping for XR course. She's also an alum of our XR Development with Unity course. She's an experienced drone videographer and a passionate XR artist. And then our last speaker for today, we will have Monday join us on stage after Angela and Miji. Monday is an alum of our XR Game Development with Unity course and our Game Development Bootcamp. He crushes Spartan obstacle races in his free time, and he's a passionate XR developer and advocate for the XR and gaming communities. So all three of them will be joining us on stage shortly here. Before I invite them up, I'm going to begin the presentation by providing a little bit of a brief overview of who CircuitStream is. So CircuitStream began in 2015 through a network of developers, designers, and creators who were pioneering the virtual and augmented reality ecosystem. CircuitStream saw a need for education and training that would empower people to build Unity and XR applications and advance the industry's frontiers. We now partner with industry-leading companies and leading educational institutions to offer courses and training to those looking to learn more about emerging technologies such as XR and game development and game design. I can still see everyone sharing their locations: Nanaimo, Vancouver, Ottawa. Amazing, amazing. And then you can see on the screen here our partners, as I just mentioned. You can also see our university partners here located on the screen as well. This slide here is a general overview of all of our course offerings. We do provide two 10-week XR development and design focused courses, and we offer two 30-week game development and game design boot camps. I'm going to take a moment to kind of break down a little bit of information on each of these courses here for you. So the 10-week XR development with Unity beginner-friendly course is project-based, and it's delivered online. In fact, all of our courses are considered to be beginner-friendly. They're all project-based, and they're all delivered online. So this course is designed for those who are interested in starting their journey into XR development. It has both synchronous and asynchronous weekly projects and assignments, and there are 8 hours of classwork and 5 office hours per week. Students complete this course with an XR developer certification. The next course is the 10-week interaction design and prototyping for XR course. It's formatted quite similarly to the XR development course with both synchronous and asynchronous weekly projects and assignments. And there are also 8 hours of classwork and 5 office hours per week. This course is meant for those interested in starting their journey into XR design. And students would complete this course with an XR designer certification. The 30-week Unity Game Development Bootcamp has 10 hours of class per week with 5 hours of live lectures, technical and career labs, and weekly office hours. This bootcamp is designed for those interested in learning Unity and game development. It teaches students how to create immersive digital worlds and bring imaginative game concepts to life. This course is beginner friendly, but it's best suited for those with a little bit of Unity experience, which you can easily gain in any of our 10-week course options as well. And students complete this course with the Unity Developer Certification, as well as Unity Associate Programmer Certification. And the 30-week Game Design Bootcamp also has 10 hours of class per week, 5 hours of live lectures, technical and career labs, and weekly office hours. This bootcamp is designed for those interested in learning game design. It teaches students how to create captivating worlds, unique gameplay mechanics, and how to bring your creative visions to life. Students complete this course with a game designer certification of completion. And then for the bootcamps themselves, they actually come with a little bit of additional career support and guidance. Our CircuitStream Career Labs teach students how to leverage technical and behavioral strengths, how to gain awareness of the Unity digital ecosystem, how to create compelling portfolios, elevate digital presence, learn how to network effectively, and become interview ready for industry jobs. Our career networking support really sets these programs apart from any others that you may find. Every student has different objectives as they come in, but those who are looking for new jobs or to improve their current positions, they really find this aspect of the course is incredibly helpful. So that's a little bit more on the boot camps. So now, without further ado, I am going to invite our first guest on stage. Again, Miji is an alum of her XR Development with Unity course, and she's going to share a little bit about her experience with CircuitStream and what she is working on now. So welcome, Miji.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Thank you so much for joining us here today. So I have a few questions here. I can start off by asking what led you to CircuitStream and what sort of skills did you learn in the XR development course with us here?
So I'm another job that I have other than my startup is I'm a Korean language teacher. So while I was teaching, I wanted to explore the way to entertain my students because I realized that if I provide very entertaining and enjoyable content to my students, and then that's when they learn the best. And then while searching for that, I stumbled upon XR and I realized it's a very great way to teach my students. And that's, I know I was searching and I realized that CircuitStream provides a very, very good program. So I took the course and then that's how I began. And the courses, the skills that I learned, so that they start from the basic of Unity. So they talk about layout, project settings, all those kind of things. And within a week, we were able to build an army of robots. That was really cool. And then we moved on to a space project. And I really wanted to challenge myself. So what I did was that I created a glowing triplet of stars orbiting around the planet. And when that happened and when I saw it on Unity, I was so proud of myself. So I was really happy about that. And then we moved on to AR project using Vuforia. And there we learned how to create a human anatomy class for that. And then we kicked off to VR lessons. And I'm actually quite passionate about VR. And when I got into the VR space in the first place, for the first time with my headset, I was, oh my God, this is the future. I was really excited. And there we learned how to do locomotions. So we do continuous movements, teleportation. We learn those kind of things. And then we also learn how to do object interactions. So by using XR rig with hands, we learn how to use a brush and we paint or interactions with buttons and all that. And at the end of the program, we were assigned into a team. There, I learned how to integrate 360 videos into the scene transitions, spawning of objects, and all other things as well. So overall, I thought the XR development course was really well-rounded program towards XR development. And the courses really helped me to boost my confidence to work on my personal project later on.
Amazing. Just a quick moment. I know I told you this before, but even as you're talking, I'm super jealous of your headset. I really like that teal headset that you've got on your side. I'm going to find one myself.
Thank you.
So the next question I have for you is, can you share some of the projects or games that you've worked on since graduating and anything that you're kind of working on right now?
Sure. I'm very excited to share all those kind of information. So right after the completion of the XR development course, one of my teammates and I, we got together and we wanted to create a meditation app. So we had discussions and we had meetings. However, unfortunately, that didn't really fall through. So in the end, it didn't really work. However, as I mentioned before, I'm a Korean language teacher. So I really wanted to work on this. So I sought ways to bring, So I started working alone by myself, and due to lack of knowledge and skills, I made progress, but it was very slow. I attended office hours. I talked to instructors. They were really helpful. So that helped me a lot. However, the progress was slower than I wanted. So what I did was I reached out to people within the Circuit Street community, and that's when it started to take off. So now we are a team of 11 people, and we worked on Core VR1, which is a Korean alphabet learning game, and we launched it on Steam. So it's available on Steam for everyone to use it. And currently we are working on Core VR2, which is a multiplayer cooking game where people go into VR space while learning how to do Korean dishes. They learn Korean language. And we are hoping to launch that on Oculus either at the end of this year or early next year. And we're also working on Japanese alphabet game that's similar to Core VR1. So, and we have other projects that we have in mind as well. So I'm very excited about those kind of things. And developing an application is quite lengthy process, from ideation, editing, developing, and launching. It's very, very lengthy. However, I learned that if you are consistent and if you're committed and if you work as a team, then you could definitely reach your goal. So if you have any personal projects in mind and you would like to do this, I recommend learn the skills and work on it, and you can create your own application in the future.
Amazing. That actually sounds really exciting too. I mean, the language component, but even just the cooking component. I mean, feel free to share that with me once that's launched, because I would love to learn how to cook some Korean food myself. So.
Oh, great. Good to hear.
Yes. And the language side would be great as well. I think I know numbers 1 to 10 in Japanese, and that's about it. So.
Oh, good. Good. Very good. Impressive.
So the next question I have for you here is, how do you stay updated with the latest trends and technologies?
Mm-hmm. I think everyone probably could agree with me, especially when it comes to technology, because staying up to date is quite important. And the most of channels that I use at the moment is through LinkedIn, because people are very passionate about XR and they share their knowledge and up-to-date news all the time on LinkedIn. So that's where I stay mostly. And a few months ago, I was very fortunate enough to be in Silicon Valley. There, I was able to attend the San Francisco Tech Week and AWE's Augmented World Expo. There, I was able to listen to experts, what they think about XR or other technology fields. I was able to try all these different headsets. I have Oculus Quest 2. That's the only thing. But I was able to try Oculus Quest Pro. I was able to try Pico, Vive. I also was able to try XR Glass X-Real. So I tried their software. I tried their hardware. I got to see 360 cameras. I was a kid in the candy shop. So I was very happy about that. And that's where I learned a lot of up-to-date information. Also, I attended Collision in Toronto. Plan to attend the Elevate Tech Festival. It's coming soon. I attend a lot of webinars and seminars to learn what other people are doing. And I'm also part of a couple of XR communities. So I'm a member there. So I share my challenges. I listen to them and I learn from them as well. So that's how I keep up to date.
Amazing. And you and I should connect on that note. I was at AWE as well.
Everything
you were just saying, I was also like a kid in a candy store, running around and putting on the snap glasses and, you know, doing interactive things in different booths. And it was a great show. If you go next year, we should connect and we should hang out while we're at AWE next year as well.
Oh, definitely. Oh yes, I'll be so happy. for sure.
Perfect. Yeah, that was a great show, though.
Oh, it was.
I also, on the game development side, I also attend GDC in California.
That's another
big show as well.
I'm envious. Yes, yeah, I would like to go to all these shows. You really learn a lot from them. So it's really fascinating. Yes.
That's where all the new announcements kind of come out. And yeah, you kind of feel like you're involved in the new discussions as things are being announced. So
definitely.
And then the last question I had for you here, Amiji, was just tell us a little bit about Core Meta.
Yes. So Core Meta is my ambitious project. It's my startup. Right after completing XR development course at CircuitStream, I registered my business, and Core Meta is an extended reality content creation company of gamified cultural and educational content for everyone. And as I've mentioned, because I'm a language teacher, we started with a language learning app. However, we plan to expand to different languages like Japanese and English, Chinese, and other languages, eventually into and then to other different fields of education, while integrating AI into XR field, eventually to become the XR platform of education for all. And we are a team of 11 people. We have developers and UX UI designers, 3D generalists and 3D designers, and also researcher. And majority of our teammates actually are from CircuitStream community. So I'm very proud, and they are awesome. They're committed, and they have a lot to offer into our team. So if you take the course at the courses at CircuitStream, you will become you'll become members of great communities. So I really strongly recommend taking the courses and enjoy the ride and be part of a group that's fascinating.
And we really do. I mean, I'm a little biased because I work here, but we really do have the best students. Like, everyone's so collaborative. Everybody works together. I mean, it probably speaks more to the industry overall. It's probably a little niche for me to say it's just our students, because everyone in the industry is incredibly supportive and collaborative. But we do have really, really good students at CircuitStream. So, well, that's awesome. Thank you, Miji. I'm going to invite you back up on stage at the end for a little bit of Q&A. But for now, I'm going to ask you to hop off, and we'll pass the microphone over to Angela so she can share a little bit about her experience.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Miji. Well, we'll see you soon.
Bye.
So Angela, you are welcome to pop up on stage here now if you like. Angela is, oh, there we go. Hi, Angela. Angela's an alum of both. She's alum of both our XR Development with Unity course and our Interaction Design and Prototyping for XR course. She's going to share a little bit about her experience with CircuitStream and what she is working on now as well. So, yes, Angela, welcome. Thank you for joining us here today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. I'm going to make you big. There we go. Perfect. And then I'm going to share just a little bit of, or ask you a few questions, I guess, and have you share some information is a better way to put it. So similar to Miji, I'll ask you, what led you to taking both of the courses with CircuitStream?
So for me, in my experience, I used to work as a graphic designer who quickly transitioned my career into like 3D art. And as I was transitioning my career into 3D art, I was also like wondering like, what kind of like niche can I take that I can pursue both of my passion in 3D art and the technology? And somehow Instagram algorithm caught my thoughts. And shout out to Instagram. And then I saw CircuitStream ad about XR courses. And when I heard that, I was like, okay, you know what? This is interesting. Like 3D art and technology, to me, XR sounded like really fun and perfect. So after doing some research, I decided CircuitStream definitely have some sort of like supportive community, which I was looking for. And I dived in. I think I got that impression because like from my interaction with the advisor, she was like really helpful.
Awesome. Yeah, we try and make sure the advisors are up to date on, you know, what the courses are offering, and they really kind of drill in the community support with their courses. So I love to hear that experience that students go through as well. So I know you took two courses with us, but just to focus a little bit on the XR design course, mm-hmm. what sort of skills did you learn in that course, and how are they kind of applicable to your career right now, even though what you're doing wasn't necessarily fully taught in the course specifically?
Right. Even though I was a 3D, I'm a 3D, like I pursue more into like 3D art side. My instructor was heavily has UX and UI design background, which was actually really helpful. Because like, well, first of all, I learned everything basic, everything fundamental about XR, like what AR is, what VR is, what MR is, and stuff like that, which I didn't even know. And so I was like, from the get-go, I was like, whoa, this is so cool, right? But then what was really helpful that I'm still using was how to do, like, from the ideation process of your project, how to pitch your client and do the market researches. And, like, when you have a project or if there's, like, other XR-related app, like, she actually taught us how to, like, analyze them, like, very thoroughly. So from that, we took it to, like, how to create a VR environment. We did a bowling alley project, and we made four different environments, like one in the mountain and one in the, like, just a bowling alley and stuff. We used a program called Shapes XR, and everyone kind of, like, worked together, which was really fun, like, in one space. Like, you could see other person throwing the cube, and then someone was playing with the triangle. Like, it was really fun, actually. And after Shapes XR, we took it to Unity and then learned more about, like, basic interface of the Unity and how to, like, optimize your model and create a scene in the Unity. Also, we touched base on AR filter, which actually piqued my interest a lot, surprisingly. I thought I was more interested in VR side, but then AR side was, like, very fascinating as well.
Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. And then I'll ask everybody this, but did you get a chance to network with any of the other students during and after the course?
Yes, of course. I wouldn't let this opportunity go. Like, when I had opportunity to network people, like, I tend to do that. I met a lot of, like, very talented people, and a lot of them are still, like, really good friend of mine. I think CircuitStream has very supportive, like, yeah, like, go get it kind of, like, community. They really do. Like, you can just reach out to your mentor, like, advisor. We have office hour every week where you can just bring your project and ask your question to your instructor. I had one-on-one sessions as well, which was very helpful for me to continue carry on with my personal project. But yeah, I think I networked heavily on CircuitStream Discord and in LinkedIn.
Awesome. And it's very rare for me to hear that any of our students aren't still connected with a lot of the community during and after the course. So I knew that was going to be a yes, but it's just nice to kind of hear that, from each student as they go through. And then maybe, are you able to share some of the projects or games that you've worked on since graduating, or anything that you're kind of working on right now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I'm actually a part of Monday, who you're gonna see soon, project called Centauri as a VR world designer along with other amazing, like, developer designer who are mostly from CircuitStream as well. And other than that, I've been working as a freelance 3D artist, like, running Instagram account, like, were, like, showing, like, 3D art for XR, how to optimize your 3D art into virtual reality. And recently I've been working on, like, doing AR filter for the branding as well.
Nice. And I think that's all I had for you here for now, just seeing what projects you are working on right now. So similarly, I'm going to invite you to come back up on stage in just a few minutes. I'll get you to swap, and we'll invite Monday to pop up on stage now. And then combined all of us together, we'll do some Q&A at the end there. So thank you. Thank you so much. And we'll see you back on stage in just a few minutes here. Perfect. And hello, Monday. Let me flip this over. My screen certainly does not need to be big right now, but we can still put it there. I wanted to show a little bit of the project that that Monday has. He shared this video with us as well. So welcome, Monday.
Hey, thank you for having me. I just feel like this is, like, the longest we've been without, like, some sort of virtual connection between the two of us.
I know. If we go longer than a week without connecting, it feels like it's been a long time, I feel now. But similarly to what we did with the other two folks here, I'm just going to ask you some questions about your experience with the courses with us, and then also what you're kind of working on now. Mm-hmm. So with that being said, I'll bring you up here. And we can start off by asking what led you to taking both the 10-week XR development course and the Unity Bootcamp with us as well, the game development bootcamp.
Yeah. So the 10-week course, I was really looking for a career change. So I come from hospital ops management. My brain is definitely like the definition of a project manager brain. And I was really getting burnt out. Like I tell everybody all the time, I felt like I was aging like four times as fast in the hospital operations management. Do not recommend it for anybody. And I knew I wanted to, like, I had the childhood dream of like breaking into the gaming industry, but everybody always says like, oh, it's a long shot and there's thousands and thousands of applications. And similar to what like Angela was saying, like that my phone listened to me and all of a sudden like CircuitStream started to pop up and I was really on the fence at first about a 10-week course. It was probably the most I had spent for like my own like independent learning outside of like my job sending me to a conference. So I was like, it's a lot of money to spend that I don't know if this is going to work out. But Tyler, I actually talked to you, which I remind you all the time that you're like the first CircuitStream face I ever met. And we kind of laid out a plan to like, okay, you're on the fence about joining a 10-week course. Why don't you join a workshop, meet some of the instructors, see some of what our curriculum looks like. And I remember I joined the Build Your Own Pokemon Go augmented reality app and honestly did not even know what augmented reality was. I was still like inching into being a techie person. And Nikisa, one of the CircuitStream instructors, Nikisa was leading it. And it blew my mind that after like, I think the workshop was like an hour and a half, but like I had my own version of Pokemon Go on my phone. And more than that, like Nikisa had gone through like, this is ways how you can expand it. This is where you can go find like asset prefabs. This is how you can connect the dots. This is how, if you want to create different types of Pokeballs and like really kind of just like laid it out. And so I fell in love with like how the course instructors lead the courses. The curriculum seemed relevant. It seemed fun. Like you were saying before, everything was like always project-based. And so that's kind of what led me into the 10-week course. And in that 10-week course, I met some great people, had some great connections. And I honestly was on the fence about the boot camp. And I promise I'm more decisive than what it seems. I was just like, I don't know if it's for me yet. But one of my really good friends from the 10-week course was like, Monday, I'm only doing this boot camp if you're doing it with me. And I'm doing the boot camp, so that means you're doing it with me. And I was still kind of on the fence, but then that's actually when I got the call from Bungie with my job offer that I had been interviewing for. And so I made the decision for the boot camp because I knew I wanted to learn more about the industry that I was now going to be a part of. And so, yeah, I joined the boot camp, learned a ton of great stuff, and it was wild to see how like I would go to the boot camp one night and learn about like, you know, object. Well, the biggest thing for me was like networking, learning about networking and servers and databases, and then going to work the next day and being like, okay, so we need to set up a dedicated server. And I was like, I know those words. I know how to do that. So yeah, it was great. But that's kind of how I made the decision for both of them.
That's awesome. So the next question I had, we're going to focus a little bit in on one of the two courses since we discussed the development 10-week course previously. I'm going to ask you a little bit about your experience in the Unity Development Bootcamp and kind of what sort of experience, I guess, you had before. You spoke to that a little bit right now, I guess, right now too, but you came from a hospital background, I guess, hospital management, you said?
Yeah. So prior to this, it was all hospital management. So I knew enough on how to break Unity, I should say that. So I was watching like YouTube videos. And of course, like you pause and you play and you pause and you play and like you learn how to make what they're teaching you how to make really, really well. But I was finding a hard time being able to take what I was watching on YouTube and apply it to like the things that I wanted to make. And so one of the things that I really liked about the boot camp was as you're making these projects along like the boot camp 30 weeks, they give you opportunities to have like mini game jam sessions or like meet with like different people to like reinforce your knowledge. And so one of the projects that I really fell in love with was the midterm project. It was supposed to be a top-down tower defense game that they give you at like 80% complete, and they give you like a checklist of like use your knowledge and your creativity to complete like the last 20%. And I was in a group with me, the guy Sebastian, who actually convinced me to take the boot camp, and one of our other friends named Gene. And it's like we had hive mind immediately. We're like, we want to be the best. We want everybody to know that we're the best. And so we took this top-down game and turned it into a VR game and like did all this crazy stuff. We did not do well scoring-wise because we did not hit the brief, which I think is hilarious, but it was just a great opportunity. And I think that was one of the first times on a project that size, on a project that size where I felt like I know enough to take what I'm thinking in my head and apply it to a project and then even take it a step further and realize that like, I didn't start this project. So I know enough about like game setup and coding to read code that I didn't write and revise and revamp it and refactor it. And I really think like the bootcamp really helped with that. I mean, 30 weeks is of course longer than 10 weeks. So you get more time just like immersing yourself in that knowledge base, but they also spend a lot more time reinforcing the fundamentals at the beginning. And then as you progress through different things, each thing is like a building block in itself. So like logically it makes sense that we would learn about networking and then we would learn about databases and like all these other things. The bootcamp was great. Like I think I learned a lot in the 10-week course, but it was almost like an appetizer. And then the bootcamp was like, this is the main course. Like this is where you get full. This is where you really like walk away and you feel like a developer because like if I was to go make like a, like a job listing for myself and like brand myself as like a consultant, I could say like, I can do databases, I can do networking, I can do 3D, I can do VR, I can do top down, I can do first person, I can do third person, like all these different things you learn how to do. So you walk away feeling like a developer.
Amazing. And well, if somebody took the 10-week developer course and they weren't necessarily as interested in game development, but they were strongly interested in Unity development, would you suggest that these skill sets that you would get from the bootcamp would still be good for them to look at moving into?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the bootcamp itself is focused on game development. You know, that's just how the curriculum is based. But you learn how to navigate Unity, where if you didn't want to do games, so that you wanted to do like what Michi's doing, like educational simulations, like you know how to build a foundation for that. If you wanted to do more of like showcase pieces for like cars, you know, when I was in the 10-week course, the first project that I ever did was PCR lab training for the hospital that I was working on. But I was able to use the concepts that I now understood from like gamifying something and just like reduce the level of gaming, increase the level of professionalism and like education. But you can definitely like, you can use it. And then, you know, just bouncing off of what Angela said as well, like there's office hours, the instructors come from a lot of different like industries and they've had a lot of different experiences. They've worked on a different projects. So even if you take the course and you're like, I don't want to make games, this is what I want to do. I mean, we had one learner who was like, I think he's some sort of physicist or something, but he is like very precise on what he wants to do. And, you know, the instructors are able to work with him to say like, okay, this is how you should probably set some things up. So I think like, even if the course itself might be geared towards gaming, you can definitely use the knowledge to like revamp whatever you're looking to do with Unity.
Amazing. And on that note too, I'll always just mention that similarly, if you were taking a development course and you wanted to learn a little bit on the design side or vice versa, we do have one-on-one with instructors. We have instructors that are qualified on both sides. So you're able to take a course on one side and still utilize the internal network of, you know, instructors and other students here and kind of learn a little bit on both sides as well. So, and then I'll ask you here, what did I have for you next? In the dynamic field of game development and XR development, how do you stay updated with the latest trends and technologies?
I play a lot of games, if you didn't notice. Like, I play a lot of games. I think the other thing that I've always tried to do is, like, I might have, like, one or two big projects that I'm working on, but it's very easy to get, like, stuck in the weeds when you're working on, like, these bigger projects that take months and sometimes years to build. So I also focus on, like, I call them weekend warrior projects, which anybody who's talked to me is probably laughing because I say it all the time, but, like, I live and breathe by it. But giving myself, like, 48 hours to take an idea that I have, or maybe I saw, like, right now I'm working on recreating like the stealth mechanic from Assassin's Creed in Unreal because I really like how they do that. But in taking time to have like really well scoped out, defined smaller projects that have a clear end goal, like my goal is not to recreate Assassin's Creed, even though I would love to do it. Like, I'm not going to do that. I just want to be able to like stealth. like if I'm in a crowd, it registers I'm in a crowd and I am hidden from enemy AI. When I step out, I'm not visible. I think it forces you, one, to get used to like project-oriented thinking, but then two, like to more answer your question, like it gives you the opportunity to experiment. Like I can experiment with like the Unity AI package because I'm not trying to figure out how to implement it across a whole project in a city of AI or something like that. Like I want one AI to have a memory that like, this is where we remembered the player last seen. And so I can like slowly integrate things like that. And also those projects, if you have an opportunity to like not, it's going to sound weird, but not be so attached to the project. Like as developers and designers, we get really attached to the thing. But when I know I probably will not touch this project in the next 48 hours, it's a lot easier for me to experiment with things that like, I probably would never use this, but it's new. And, you know, I see other people using it. So sure, let's use this new mechanic or this new pack or this new like coding technique or something like that, knowing that like, is a part of my day-to-day repertoire? Probably not. But can I at least say that like I'm knowledgeable about it? Absolutely. I have a project to prove it. Here you go.
Absolutely. Well, and yeah, you never know when somebody's going to bring it up in conversation or if it actually lands on your plate randomly in a project that you weren't expecting sort of thing, right?
Yes. Especially if you outsource yourself. So like, you know, if you decide to be an entrepreneur like Meiji or, you know, an influencer, like Angela's always, I'm sure, looking for new content. So maybe this is more for her. Like you got to stay up to date with that stuff. So if you get used to using new techniques and like exploring new instead of like relying on like what you're good at, it's just going to help build your personal brand as well.
Absolutely. And I had to shout out, there's a little comment there. It said nice Destiny 2 jacket.
Oh, yeah. So perks of working for Bungie, kind of say it.
What did I have for you here? So, can you discuss any recent trends or advancements in the game development and XR development industry that have currently captured your attention?
Oh, I mean, the name of the game is AI right now. So I love it. I've tried to implement it as much as possible. I just talked about like I'm trying to recreate Assassin's Creed stealth mechanic, but really that's me trying to see like how much awareness and knowledge and memory can I pump into an AI character and like have that dictate their behavior. So if they, like right now I'm trying to figure out the logic that like Metal Gear Solid stealth with like the cardboard box, like can they remember that like I was in, like that box has moved, like can they remember location? Like that's pretty easy, but can they remember that like last time they played, that box wasn't there, or last time the enemy was in this room, that box wasn't there, or hey, like two levels ago, you killed my best friend because you jumped out of a box. So now like, I'm aware that that's a tactic that you use and the AI is kind of evolving to force the players to play better. I love where AI is going. I think from like a developer side, it's gonna make development easier because it's gonna be less grunt work of like, oh gosh, I gotta write the code, and more like creative logic around like, can I think through the code and give enough information to AI to generate the effect I'm looking. From design, you go from designing, maybe taking a week to design one sword or one gun from a game to like, if I give the input, I can design like 25 of them, like a whole season's worth of content in a week. Like it's insane. And I think like for the games that like RPG games, I think are gonna have the biggest boost from that when we want as much immersion as possible. I read an article recently where they said they're trying to pump AI into Sims to make the Sims essentially exist offline. So like your Sim, instead of it being like, oh, you came back after 6 hours. So they give you all this like randomized, like this is what happened at your job. And this is who called you. And your Sim is hungry because it's been 6 hours. Like, it's like, no, you left your Sim alone for a week and he decided to learn how to cook and decided to become a personal chef and opened up a restaurant and has a girlfriend. And like, all these different things. And so I'm really most excited about AI. I think that's the thing I'm keeping my eye on the most.
That's really neat. I love hearing how AI is being integrated into video games, into tech. Mm-hmm. Even the last two conferences that I went to, I was kind of asking. And yeah, there was a few game developers who were creating NPCs within their games that were, you have a completely different interaction with them every time you play the game, because it's all based on AI tech, which I mean, for somebody like myself, I've been gaming for quite a few years now. I just laugh. I'm like, geez, like that was completely different than what I grew up gaming with. So I'm also very excited to see the AI tech kind of working its way in. And then the last question I had for you is, can you share any projects or games that you've worked on since graduating or anything that you're kind of working on right now?
The biggest game I'm working on, I'm really happy. I got a job with Bungie, so I'm working on Marathon, which is exciting. I can't wait for like that game to come out and completely like rock people's socks off who are used to like Bungie does Destiny, but can Bungie do other things? So really excited for Marathon. Personal project wise, you know, I talked about the tower defense game. So we've continued working on that game for about 2 years now, and it's now Project Centauri that I get to work with Angela and a few other CircuitStream alums on. So we're currently a team of eight, split between two developers, three designers, and then me and Sebastian, who was the gentleman that convinced me to do the boot camp. We all kind of form like our project team. And so that's a VR shooter that we've really tried to incorporate a lot of like the third person and first person, like competitive shooter aspects into a VR space. And it's just like coming together like beautifully. Like I'm so happy every time I get to put on the headset and play in it. So those are the big two. Outside of that, you know, just keeping like little mini projects going. Every once in a while, I try to convince myself that this is the weekend where I'm going to learn to understand Blueprint and Unreal. And then I get in there and I hate it because it doesn't make sense. I'm like, it shouldn't be this hard. But I think with my like tackling stealth mechanics in Unreal starting to have me like appreciate that engine and the logic that they put into that. But really, Centauri is my biggest personal project right now.
I was trying to time this up nicely as you were speaking and get it up. And of course, my tech wasn't working on my side. So but the preview that everyone can see here is the project that Monday's talking about. This is a little preview here. I think if you're interested, this is right on YouTube too, isn't it?
Yeah. So I will say I'm like an old man when it comes to social media. So I don't post often, but I do have a YouTube xr.journey that I'll throw in the chat once I jump off stage that has kind of like a pseudo devlog of like videos and just different things that we're putting in. But and then the video you're seeing, so that's one of our maps. So you can see like we have weapon spawning. One of our developers, Silver, has done a really great job with like hand poses to make like everything you can touch inside of the game has a hand pose. So it's not just like, oh, it's VR and the sword kind of fits in my hand. Like, no, you're really holding a sword. It looks really good. But yeah, I will share my YouTube link so that way if anybody wants to keep up with it, for sure. And then we do have a playtest coming up. So if anybody's interested in that, you know, definitely connect with me. More than happy to get eyes on the project and get feedback as we can continue to work on it.
You know why I want to see it, so share that with me, please. But for anybody else there, feel free to reach out to Monday. In fact, reach out to any of the speakers that we have here today. I didn't ask them in advance, but Angela and Miji, if you have LinkedIn profile links, feel free to share those in the chat. You don't have to rush into it right now. I'm going to share a little bit more course information before you come back up on stage. But if you do get the chance before the end of the presentation, make sure you share your profiles in the chat there for everybody. And Monday, thank you. Obviously, it's we chat all the time, so it's a pleasure chatting with you again, as always. I'll ask you to hop off now. I'm just going to share a little bit of course information, and then in about 5 minutes, I'll invite all three of you back up. Perfect. So let's make this big. You don't need to see my face that big right now. Awesome. So I'm going to invite, like I said, all three of them back up on stage in a minute, but I'm just going to share a little bit of the cohort and upcoming course information for everybody. I will also remind everybody that if you haven't interacted in the polls tab, feel free to go in and respond to the polls that we have in there. If you do have any questions that you've been thinking of during this presentation that you haven't written down yet, feel free to put those into the questions tab. I can see we do have a couple loaded up there for afterwards, but if you have any more, we're happy to kind of take a little bit of time and go through those. All of our cohorts typically run every few months. The upcoming cohort for the XR Development with Unity course runs from October 2nd through to December 7th. And the Interaction Design and Prototyping for XR course runs from September 6th through to November 15th. And then in terms of the bootcamp cohorts, they actually both start and complete on the same date. So both the Game Development Bootcamp and the Game Design Bootcamp run from October 3rd, 2023 through to May 7th, 2024. And we do offer different financing options depending on which region you are from. For any students located in the US and in Canada, we are partnered with Climb and with Affirm to offer monthly payment options. If you're located outside of the US or Canada, you can take advantage of our deferred monthly payment plans. Basically, whenever you're ready to apply or to get enrolled, you can just reach out and our enrollment advisors can help answer any questions that you have about the pricing, the different payment plans that we offer, and just make sure that you pick the right one that's suited best for you there. And then we have an exciting offer for all of the attendees that are attending the event here today. We're actually offering a 15% off of all of the courses, which is kind of crazy. So that would mean you can get 15% off of the 10-week XR development with Unity course, 15% off of the 10-week interaction design and prototyping course, 15% off the 30-week game design bootcamp, and also on the 30-week game development bootcamp. So these offers, the promotions are available until September 30th or until the cohorts are full. I do know that the design cohort is coming up. The next one starts, I think it starts next week. So if you had your heart set on that course and you were looking to get started, we likely can apply this promotion for a future start date. So just reach out and let us know. We can take a look at the availability and just make sure that you have access to courses there. And I'm going to share these links on screen here. These are through for enrollment through CircuitStream and also through our university partners. I'll just pause here for a brief moment. Feel free to jot down any of these links. If you were looking to register for a course directly through CircuitStream, obviously you can just go to circuitstream.com. But if you are located in Canada and you're looking to go through UBC or UFT or U of A, those would be the main links that you can access the courses there. I'm also going to send out a recording of this entire presentation to everybody in attendance here today. So feel free to take these down, make a note, but you'll also get a recording of this presentation afterwards. So these links will be within that recording for you too. And then if you do have any questions about the courses, if you're considering enrolling, but you just have a few questions that you kind of want to go through first to make sure that is the right fit, you can reach out to us directly. This is the 1-800 number for CircuitStream, and this is the direct email address for CircuitStream here. You can also visit us at circuitstream.com. We have all the course information, all of our events posted on there. We have blogs, we have lots of valuable information, but you can also connect with an advisor directly through the website and schedule a meeting that way too. And that's it for the formal part of the presentation. So I'm going to close this screen here and I will invite all of our speakers back up on stage here. And I'm just going to take a quick look and see what we've got in the questions tab so we can kind of get started on that. So welcome back up on stage, Monday. Hello, Miji. Hello, Angela. Hello, hello.
Hello.
So hello. Between the four of us, we'll do our best to answer these questions that come up here. So let's start with this one here. I'm interested in the XR development course, but not for gaming industry. What would be the career path or additional courses to pursue? I think Monday and I kind of touched on this actually just a minute ago there, but Monday, do you want to maybe touch on that again?
Yeah, for sure. So the XR Dev 10 week, I think would probably still be a place that I would highly recommend you start at, just because it's going to teach you a lot of like the different entry points of XR Dev. So like Michi was saying, like there's a VR portion, there's an AR portion. You also learn a little bit of like 3D, which builds like a foundation of Unity. So it's less focused on, like, of course the projects are games, just because like it's easier to make a project for a game than anything else, but you can definitely use your knowledge and apply it to different things. And then even if it's an area that you're focused on that's very specialized, like you have the CircuitStream instructors, you can go to office hours, you can connect with like your peers and everything like that. But the XR Dev 10-week course gives you a pretty firm foundation on like the three major aspects of XR Dev that like most industries are looking for, like, you know, developers or designers to have like an understanding of, and then you can kind of branch into a specialty from there.
That's, I couldn't have said that better myself. That's like exactly what where my brain went with that one. So perfect. And then we have I guess this one is directly for you, Monday. Question for Monday. you may have also already answered this, sorry, but after receiving the education at CircuitStream, how long did it take you to land your job at Bungie?
Oh, yeah. So I got my job at Bungie like a week before I started the boot camp. Time is relative, and I do not remember how long after the 10-week course that was, but I think I will say specifically for my role at Bungie, I was able to leverage my background in management for the role that I was able to get. So I definitely knew that even if I did like a world where I was a developer or an engineer, I knew that I did not have enough skills to be competitive in that space, just because you're competing with people who went to like 4-year degrees and even longer than that to be like computer science engineers and like software engineers and different things like that. So I knew I wanted to be in the gaming industry, and I looked at like what management would look like. And since I was coming in with like too many years of management experience, I was able to leverage that and build a very strong portfolio, saying that like, I am a strong manager who also knows enough about game dev to make these three projects that I'm highlighting in my portfolio. But it wasn't long. I mean, it was, gosh, I really don't remember how long after the 10-week course, but I was applying for jobs as soon as I like had enough confidence in the 10-week course. I think I was applying for jobs like by week like 5-6, maybe I was applying for jobs. And Bungie had already shown interest in me before I got done with XR Dev, just with what I was able to speak to and like the prior experience that I had, which is why I was able to get that role before the bootcamp even started.
Yeah, and just to add to that, it's I started off in the advisor role here. I mean, Monday shared that I was the first person that he kind of spoke to when he was taking the course. But I had that question a lot. There's a lot of people who are maybe unhappy with the industries that they're in, or they're just looking for a change, and they're looking for a way to kind of break into a new industry. So usually the advice I would give to people is, if you're looking to combine this education with prior career experience, or if you're looking to combine it with something that you're currently doing in your job at that time, it's probably going to be easier for you to land a role a little bit faster with that combination. Whereas if you're looking to do a complete career flip, this is still an amazing path for you to start that. It's just going to take a little bit longer, as it would with any complete career flip, for you to get the proper skills, and build yourself to that level. In other words, I would never recommend that somebody taking our 10-week course as a new beginner, I wouldn't recommend that they apply for a senior developer role, as soon as they complete the 10-week course. But if they continue to build their skill sets over 6 months to a year to 2 years after that, they're involved in the community, they keep taking courses, they take boot camps, things like that, they very well could be in that position after that amount of time. I see people land all different types of roles after they come up the courses with us, but it kind of depends on how they attack it. If they're combining it with previous education or experience, they're starting brand new. So hopefully that adds a little bit to the answer there that you were asking there for Monday. But obviously Monday's response was a little bit more directly what you wanted, but just trying to add some value there too to that as well. And I can see Angela and Miji nodding as well. So I think they're in agreement with this.
I just wanted to add a bit more, because especially about not just gaming, for when it comes to XR, most of the community members I've met during this circus stream, they were not really in for gaming. A lot of people came from theater, music industry, or I've seen people who's creating in a VR concert theme too. And also, if you look at all these posts about XR, there's very heavily focused on the medical training or a very hazardous situation like fire training. Also, TD Bank in Canada, they also tried to create some kind of financial educational program there too. So I'm pretty sure that whatever you're interested in, if you combine that with XR, that's a possibility. And you could apply it anywhere, especially now Apple Vision Pro is coming. They're promoting spatial computing too. It's going to be there everywhere before you know it. So yes, it's applicable everywhere.
And then Monday, sorry, we both of us jumped in there. All of us, I think, started talking at the same time. Did you have anything else you wanted to add there, Monday, or was that?
Oh yeah. I was just going to add as well. If you are applying for roles as like a developer or engineer, like a lot of companies are starting to group those, like they're calling EIC hires, but like early in career transitioning hires. And they start posting those like around, like, I would say like what, maybe like April, May, because usually they start posting those jobs when they start posting for like summer intern roles. So if you are like in that career transition, like it might be something where like a lot of companies are looking for it, but you have to look for like EIC roles or transition roles that get posted like a lot sooner than what you would typically expect that role to be, because they, at least at Bungie, we group them with like our intern, like they go through the same pipeline. And so usually when we start posting for interns, we're also posting for like career transition individuals as well.
Absolutely. And just on that note as well, I'm just going to keep adding things to what you guys are saying here, I guess, but we're We're partners with Bungie, and we actually work with their early career division as well. So for the bootcamp students, as they come to the end of the course, they get the opportunity to showcase their projects as well. We do a showcase event where we invite our community partners in to see that. So just something else that can assist with the career side after you take the courses with us there. So what else do we have here? What is the difference between going through CircuitStream versus our university partners? I can probably answer this one. I feel like this one's more catered towards me. So the courses themselves, the content is exactly the same. The only difference, I guess, is if you're taking a course through one of the universities, you would get additional certification from the university partner. The education itself, the certification in terms of being partnered with Unity on the CircuitStream side is exactly the same. It's just if you take the course through University of Toronto, for example, you're also going to get the certification backed by University of Toronto because that's where the course came through. So if you're looking for additional university certification, just sign up through one of the university partners that we have. Perfect. And then is there, maybe you can help me with this one, Monday, or any of you. I don't know if all three of you are probably in it, but does anybody have access to the link for the Discord server for us? Can you share it in the chat if you do? Sorry, none of us prepared for this in advance. I just saw the question come up.
I can probably be able to search it.
Yeah, I'd normally do it, but I can't do it while I'm running this at the same time. But we do have a Discord server. You're absolutely welcome to connect with the community there. We would love you to connect. We will do our best to throw them in the chat there. If we don't get it in for any reason, just reach out to us and we can absolutely connect you to the Discord server, no problem. And then I'm going to let all three of you answer this one. Do you have any suggestion as to which headset would be a good first purchase to get into development?
It's biased. Like I don't hate saying it, but like the Oculus Quest 2 is not the best headset out there by any means, but it is the most like entry point friendly. And the CircuitStream curriculum is based around like the Oculus headset. So like if you're specifically trying to get a headset to follow along with like what your instructors are doing, like Oculus Quest 2. I say that as I have two of them sitting behind me, but I actually love my Vive headset. Like quality game experience is so much better. And then if you really want to get crazy, you can get like a Vario headset because those are some really nice headsets. But first purchase, I would say Quest 2 would be my vote.
I mean, I would say the same thing. I'm quite biased because I only have Oculus Quest 2. So the reason I recommend the Quest 2 is if you plan to launch your app on Oculus or somewhere, and if you want the most exposure, then that's Oculus Quest is the most commonly used around the world. So I would recommend that too. But one day when it comes to quality, definitely Vario or Vive. Oh, yes, definitely. And even the pass-through too, right? So if you look at the pass-through of Oculus Quest and even Oculus Quest Pro, there's a huge difference. And I can't wait for Apple Vision Pro. So I would like to try that in the future.
I have Quest 2 as well. I think a Quest 2 is a good choice for the beginner. It's just like accessible, you know, the price range is pretty fair too. Mm. We had a student who came with the Oculus Quest Pro actually. She was like, Quest Pro, and everyone's like, wow. But, you know, she does so many different things because like Quest Pro is more for developer, I believe. Mm. Yeah, but then Quest 2 does a great job.
Amazing. Yeah, better answers than I can give on these. You guys are a little bit more immersed into these fields than I am personally, but I'm excited to try the Apple one as well, but that's just because it's everywhere right now. All right. Let's see. Are there some favorite employers that frequently hire CircuitStream graduates? And if so, for programming 10 or 30 week boot camps, are people entering the industry as an intern level or junior level yet? So we think we touched on this a little bit already. Monday kind of dove into the intern side and the early career side, at least for Bungie. But Bungie would be one of our partners. I mean, Unity is a partner. We have actually, you know what, rather than kind of going through, I don't want to leave anybody out. It's going to be silly for me to try to remember them all off the top of my head here. But I can share our partners with you if you want to have more of a conversation. We've got many partners, lots of hiring partners, both on the XR side and also on the game development and game design side. So
And then I also wanted to chime in. Also, we are in the we are also in talk with CircuitStream as well as a business partner, Core Meta, so that we are planning to have provide some internship as well in the future.
Absolutely. And actually, I was just when I was at AWE, I connected with a few different companies there as well. And I believe two or three of the connections I made at that conference have already looked to take on some of our students as interns too. So there's another a meditation app as well that was out there. I think he was
Zen.
Zen, that's right. Yeah. Yes, yes.
I connected with him too.
Yeah, I liked his booth. Really nice guy. So yeah, and I mean, we partnered. Snap's a partner with us. We just did an event with Snap a couple of weeks ago. I also connect with Steven when I was at AWE. That's where I met him, and we decided to do this event together, and we became official partners. So nice. Yeah, lots of companies, lots of opportunities. And then in terms of the level, intern and junior levels is generally the way that you'd be entering. If you took the 6-month bootcamp, for example, and you were working in your industry for many years and you're super qualified in your industry, there's a good chance you could take something like the bootcamp education and move into something that's a little bit higher than an intern or a junior level. But that's usually the safe approach to say, yeah, intern and junior level would be the way to kind of break into any industry, really. But for XR and for gaming too.
Yeah.
Cool. And then here we go. Would it be a problem if I don't have a headset when doing the 30-week development program bootcamp? I'll let someone answer that one because he took it.
Yeah. So the 30-week development bootcamp is not it's not XR. So it's just Unity game development. So you actually don't need a headset. Like none of the curriculum that you'll learn will ever dive into VR. You can definitely apply it to VR if you decide that that's what you want to do. Like I did for like the midterm or for some of like the game jams or even for like your capstone project, you can definitely like go the route of VR. But the curriculum that the instructors are going to be following is all based on 3D Unity development. So yeah, you don't need a headset for that one at all.
And I don't know if anybody else wants to speak to this too. For the 10-week courses, the XR focus courses, we usually recommend having a headset. But the reality is the education that you're learning, everything that you're learning in Unity, for example, is kind of done through a computer system. So you can learn the majority of the education without having to have a headset, but it's going to, on the XR side at least, it's going to allow you to kind of interact with the creations that you're developing or designing on a little bit on a higher level. So I've had students reach out to me at the early stages and say, I really want to take this course, but in terms of an investment, do I invest in a headset and then wait and take the course, or do I invest in a course and then get the headset? Usually I'd say the course first, because you can get the headset afterwards if you want to, and you can start to learn the education, but it's going to be different for everybody. But I just wanted to add that in for the 10-week courses as well.
Yeah, I agree with Tyler as well. Also, after you're done with the course, you have an access to revisit the course as well. So you can always go back to the VR portion, because like without a headset, you will miss out to the virtual reality portion. But then as a design student, like we went through, most of the time we went through like AR filter and you know how to create like stuff in the Unity. So yeah, like you can definitely get the headset later.
Great point. I was just gonna say, that's a great point. You can always go back and access all of your course education as well. So you can go back with a headset and look at things a little bit differently a few weeks later. But sorry, Michi, go ahead.
But if you're passionate about VR, I think I definitely recommend you to have a headset eventually, especially if you're into design or development. I think everybody here can agree. Once you design something, like say environment, if you design on 2D computer screen, that looks very nice. But when you actually design something, you go in, you get to see some kind of flaws time to time that you never actually noticed in 2D. So I think if you are serious about developing something in VR space, so then I strongly recommend it, because in the end, it becomes quite essential.
100%. Awesome.
And then in terms of the headsets, the guidance there, just kind of about how we previously answered and, you know, what the most popular ones are. And then if you're looking to get a little bit more immersive with it, a little bit more detailed, some of the pricier options as well. So,
yeah.
So that's that there. Let's see here. I'm currently enrolled. I'm currently enrolled in the Unity Bootcamp in October. I'm very eager to get a job in the industry, and I'm curious about how common it is for people to get work while they're enrolled in the program. Well, I mean, so Monday's a really good example, just because he's sitting here right now and he took the 10-week course and then he basically got his job as he was going in to take the bootcamp. But, you know, I think what he said too kind of resonated with me. Once you're comfortable and once you're feeling confident in the course and in your skill sets, at least on a base level, that's when I'd encourage you to start putting your name out there, looking for job opportunities. As you go, you know, towards the end of the course, you're going to have more confidence. You're going to be connected with more people in the industry. You might even have other people who could say, hey, you know, I know this company is looking for this, or, you know, whatever the case may be. But yeah, I mean, that's usually what I would say, but I'll let you guys kind of add to that too.
Yeah. I was just going to add in to it was the 30-week bootcamp is kind of like, as much as it's a progression of like you as a developer, it's kind of like your career journey as well. So throughout those 30 weeks, like Tyler alluded to earlier, there is a whole career portion where you're learning about personal branding and building a portfolio and how to I don't want to say like slide in somebody's DMs, but like how to like message email people on like LinkedIn and stuff like that. But like all of these like good professional skills kind of grow as well. So I think a lot of times like it's like not a good metric to say how many people get while they're enrolled in the program, because like while you're enrolled, you're still part of that career journey. I will say that this past bootcamp, we did have two people that got job offers immediately after showcasing their capstone project, like barely even got off the stage and they had somebody in their inbox like, I want to interview you for this like new junior level role. And that was really exciting. I know both of them are really excited about like where that could potentially take them to, and they're still talking about it. But I think it goes to show that like you might not get something while you're in the program, but the person you are as a developer, as a career professional, as someone in the industry, like you have a wild opportunity to make a very loud impact with that capstone project, because, you know, the industry partners are there. It's some of your best work. You're there talking about your portfolio and everything like that. And that we have been able to, like CircuitStream has been able to prove, like you can get a job just from that, because we have two people that did it.
Also to just piggyback on Monday, I think, I guess everyone has a different goal in terms of career, right? My best interest is like stay as a freelancer. So my best interest is to develop my personal brand. But I think no matter like whether you're taking 10-week course or the bootcamp, like how well you did in the class, if you don't take that like learn like knowledge outside of the class and then start networking with people, like it's really, I think that's also your personal ability, right? Like how to find that opportunity. Cause like, My impression on CircuitStream, like network, there's always some kind of collaboration or job opportunity. Like I always get a notification. So like it's whether you are able to like reach out to them and showcase your project or your skill.
I strongly agree with Angela for sure. Yes. I mean, I know several people who have taken the boot camp, and some of them are part of our core meta too. And they're always, what I see from them is they're always consistent and they're always updating their knowledge and they're working and they're always passionate about improving their skills and improving their project as well. And they're not only doing our group project, but they also work on their personal project to increase their abilities. So yes, it really depends on the individual and how consistent and persistent they are.
Yeah. So just get involved. That's the biggest message. As you go through, be as involved as you can in the course and the communities, you know, and then taking Monday's advice, once you get some confidence in the skill sets that you're learning, start reaching out, put your name out there. You know, even if it's jobs that you don't think you're qualified for, I always recommend just put yourself out there, just do everything that you can as you're kind of going through that stage, and continue to network and continue to learn, and opportunities will certainly present themselves. So, and we'll
assist on our side.
Please.
Yeah. And you know, don't be scared. Like really, CircuitStream did great job of growing the community of like very supportive community. So everyone's like, go get it, you know, like nobody's going to bite you though. So
no, we're all everyone's friendly. Very helpful. Monday can be a little mean sometimes, but most of the time we're all really friendly.
when I have to be, I will put my foot down. Like, yeah, Angela and I work together. She knows how to get it done.
There's a question here. What do we have? For the badges. To clarify about the university partners, is it a badge that is co-branded or considered a certificate? I believe the university portion is the co-branded badge, and then you receive the certificate through CircuitStream. And then let me go here. Are they going through the university partners? Are they self-paced, pre-recorded? So the courses themselves are going to run the same format for both the universities and through CircuitStream directly. So there's going to be a combination of live classes, asynchronous, synchronous, just different sorts of projects. This presentation, I'm going to send a recording. So if you want, just flip back through in the recording and take a look at the course descriptions and kind of how it breaks down. You can also just go to circuitstream.com and click on each of the courses and kind of take a look through that way as well. But in terms of the university partners versus CircuitStream, they're all delivered the exact same way. And it'll be asynchronous and synchronous and kind of just, it's all project-based basically is the biggest part of it to take away. So.
Yeah.
And it's all recorded. So everything you can, there's pre-recorded portions, but even all of the live recorded portions are also recorded for you to keep afterwards in reference too. So I said recorded way too many times, but we all got the point. Any Pistol Whip fans, former Cloudhead backend engineer here? Nice to meet you all.
It's in my list.
What? So Pistol Whip was actually one of the first games that I set out to like reproduce when I was trying to learn how to do VR. I called it Last Train to Paris because I'm a huge Kanye Jay-Z fan. And yeah, I love it. Angela, you need to see this is, yeah, we need to schedule time to play Pistol Whip because it is so much fun.
I'm so down. I just get jump scared a lot when I'm playing VR. Like most of VR game that I play is like, really cute, like there's this like really like adorable mouse that I'm like taking it to adventure, do high five.
Mm-hmm. I don't think there's jump scares. I will say like Pistol Whip for me is like probably the most non-motion sickness I've ever been playing a game long term, because you don't move, it moves for you and you just kind of like interact, which makes it so like I don't get sick. Like I'm not walking at one pace or like moving a joystick or something like that. Like everything is moving around me. And I'm just kind of here.
I mean, I was screaming the entire time when I was playing Super Hot. So
now I want to play. I haven't played this one yet.
I would say this is more low key than Super Hot. It's like the same type of energy, just like delivered differently. But I like Pistol Whip. I personally like Pistol
Definitely
Whip.
Definitely gonna try
Super Hot.
Oh, I'm gonna try too. And honestly, if you're your backend engineer at Cloudhead, we should connect too. I'd love to get Cloudhead added to the list of partners too at CircuitStream. So feel free to connect with me, Jonathan. I'd love to chat with you. And then how common is remote work in the industry now? I would still say it's very common, but I'll let maybe the three of you speak to that as well.
Nope,
I mean, I'm a freelancer, so pretty sweet.
I mean, I agree. I know there's still like some studios that are doing some sort of like hybrid work or like in studio work for like people who need to be in studio, but I'm seeing that more at like C-suite level, like the people who sit in the meetings. But like for developers and designers, I think the industry is starting to really understand that like creatives need to be creative in spaces that they want to be creative in. And so like not even just like work remote, like I'm seeing some companies that are doing like work from anywhere, and then you get people who are like in Bali, and it's okay that they're in Bali because they're working, but like we want creatives to be comfortable to like continue to produce at that creative level. And I'm starting to understand that like that a cubicle is not conducive to that. And sometimes your home office is not conducive to that. Like sometimes you do need to like just get away. So I think it's becoming more and more prevalent, and I'm starting to see like more extensions of working remote pop up.
And for Core Meta, we are 100% remote. So all 11 of us, we don't have a physical office, and everyone is spread everywhere around the world. We have someone in Germany, India, US, West Coast Canada, East Coast Canada. And that's how we work right now. And that's how I actually like, because I can get skills from anywhere. And then we just get together and we make it done. So I think remote work is possible for sure, at least in my case.
Mm-hmm. And jokes aside, when you actually search for like, I mean, in my perspective, when I search for like game designing job, like most of time I see remote positions, at least in the gaming industry.
Absolutely. And I can just kind of back up all support, I guess, all three of those responses. So I do a little bit of the career support for the students through CircuitStream as well. So when I go to these conferences, I have lots of conversations with people, and usually I'm asking, you know, if I'm talking to a company based out of China, I have to ask if they're hiring remote. We do have students in China, but the bulk of our students, the majority are probably North American based. So I'm always just looking for opportunities. And I'd say probably about 50% of the companies I talk to say that there's remote opportunities, and about 50% say they've got physical office, or that's probably not even accurate, because there's a good percentage that are also a combination of both of those. So definitely remote opportunities, just to kind of back up all three of your responses there. I've had lots of conversations with the industry, and there's definitely remote opportunities everywhere. So, and then I think this is the last one here. What are the standard rates for freelancers in the industry? This would be a really hard question to answer.
I guess for the game design, I think it's really depends on which, like, your skill set level and what you can showcase. I think beauty of freelancing, the reason why I've been in freelancing industry for so long, is like you can actually adjust your rate based on your skill set, what you're bringing into value. And I know it's a cliche, but It is what it is, I think. But I usually charge like for the logo design, and then if I do AR filter as well, I usually charge between 3,000 to 5,000 per gig.
And then as you, starting off early, and then as you advance your skill sets, it's only going to be, you know, you start lower, and then you increase as your work gets better. So. Amazing. Well, I think that's all the questions. I'm just going to look at the chat tab really quickly here as well, just to make sure we're not missing any questions. Looks like it's just some good conversations happening here. So I think that's it. So I'll just take a moment here and thank all three of you again for joining us here for this presentation. This was awesome. Everyone in the chat, please feel free to source all three of these lovely humans on their LinkedIn, connect with them, follow kind of what they're working on. I'm excited to see the project that you're going to share with me Monday, and actually I want to do the Korean cooking one as well. So thank you everyone for joining us here today. It's been an amazing session, and we have another session. We have a workshop, I believe, next week. It's on September 7th, and it is for people who are looking to create their first virtual reality app. It's kind of an introduction to XR development on the VR side. So. Feel free to register for that. Thank you again, everyone in the audience, and to all of our speakers. And we will look forward to seeing you at the next CircuitStream event.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks for having me. See you.
Bye, everybody.